Hello again. In this episode, I'm going to be going through the reconditioning process for each of these parts. Some of them need replating, some of them need replacing, some of them need painting, but they all need a good clean to start with. Before I get stuck into that though, I want to return to the spline shaft problem I had because it was stuck in the hub. Now this side, as I showed before, was absolutely fine. This left-hand side was the problem one though. As you can see, I've got it apart. A local motorsport company let me use their press, which was rated to 30 tons. At about 25 tons, there was a big bang, and this started to come out finally. It's not without its problems though. You can see the thread on the end of the spline shaft here has got some damage to the threads, and it started to splay out a little bit. In the rest of this episode, I'm going to be covering the cleaning, preparation, and refurbishment of each individual component, starting with these big pieces, and moving on to the rest. There's a lot of it, so I've got a lot of work to do. I'm sending some parts to be sandblasted tomorrow, including the suspension link, so I need to get the universal joints out in order for them to be sandblasted, because I don't really want the machine faces of the flanges here to be sandblasted. First of all, though, you have to get these circlips out here. So you can use circlip pliers like these to undo these, but the problem is these old ones where they've been kind of in there for a long time, they're really quite reluctant to come out. So the way to get these going is start drifting it, otherwise you'll ruin your circlip pliers. Okay, and you can see that bending away, so it's spring steel. I now get this screwdriver behind there. Start to work it out, there we go. So obviously it's quite happy to stay in there because it's been there a long time. You just have to kind of bend it out and eventually it will just come. And there we go. Getting this part out, which here's one that's already been removed, there's loads of those little needle bearings in there that make up the universal joint. So I need to drift that out. And the way you do that is by whacking the hell out of this part of the yoke. Now, when I first did one of these, I couldn't believe it would actually work, but it does. So you can't really be subtle about it. So I'm using this copper hammer because I really don't want it to be steel on steel. So this is softer, but really you've just got to go for it. Okay, so after just a few hits, you can see that that's already proud of the surface there coming out. Okay, nearly there. And out it comes with a spray of needle bearings. I've taken the needle bearings out, but press that in, because of course, if that's sandblasted, it will diminish the tolerances in there. And here's my collection of parts to go out and to be sandblasted. I can do the smaller parts myself, but really a lot of this will take me too much time to do. So here we are a day later. Freshly sandblasted parts ready for paint or powder coating, and then new bushes, bearings, and reassembly. So to drift the two races of bearings out, I'm using a socket that's slightly smaller than the hole in the yoke here, and a larger socket the other side. As I tighten the vise, this socket will push both races of bearings through and into that larger socket. I'm going to see it go already. What a nice smooth action, it feels good. There we go, that's both through. So now I've taken off the grease nipples and I'm going to clean out any residual grease from the whole part, as well as obviously particularly in where the bearings are. I've been looking at these safety straps and realised that they're completely different shapes. And it's bizarre because they do the same job, but weirdly when you overlay them, they actually, the holes almost align just via a completely different route. So this is what it actually should look like, albeit this bit here is a little bit bent, so I'll straighten that up shortly. So I figured that it would be worth having a go at straightening out. Steel is amazingly resilient stuff, and you can bend it to whatever shape you want to, pretty much. So with the other one as a reference, I can actually have a good go at sorting this out. You can already see it. I tend to use the vise as a bit of an anvil as well. Okay, with that already, they're looking a lot closer to each other, which is good. So I'll carry on tweaking this and get to the point where they're the same shape. Okay. There we are. So this time, because the UJs aren't actually in there, I can drift out
tabs. There we go.
The anti-roll bar drop link here had to be cut off because one of the bolts, I couldn't get this to stop spinning in either the socket or the spanner that I put on it. But it does come in handy having a load of old sockets that you don't mind hitting about a bit. And I'll just cut the rubber off the edge here. Give the socket more clearance. Right, so next up to take apart and get the nuts off the end, clean up the threads, are these fulcrum shafts. So this is the one for the that goes on the bottom of the hub. I don't want any damage to happen to this shaft at all, so hence the use of the cloth in the vise. So with that off, there's a really nice thread there. This has always been kept well lubricated, so there's minimal scoring, a little bit of scoring in the middle there, but that's absolutely reusable. So I've come across a bit of a problem on this fulcrum shaft. See that the thread on the end here has just gone entirely, so corrosion set in and I need to replace this one. Shaft, the springs and dampers mount too. Okay, I've got one side off already. Now for the large bottom wishbone fulcrum shaft. Very nice, nicely preserved thread and a really good fulcrum shaft. I'm using the vise here to drift out the remaining universal joints from the stub shaft. Okay, once you've got one side out, the other side is much easier. So again, what I'm going to do here is take out these needle bearings and put the cap back into the yoke of the spline shaft here so that I can then sandblast these parts. You can flush with the surface so it can clean up nicely. So the next thing on the list to prepare for sandblasting is the piston carrier. So this is the brakes and the disc runs in here. Okay, so those just sit in grooves in the casting here. Now the handbrake mechanism deserves a little section all to itself, to be honest. As I showed before, this is the lever that actuates the system and this is the spring that pulls the two pads apart. So inside here is a mechanism that adjusts for when the pad wear needs it to close back in again. The pads themselves are actually retained onto these pad carriers just by this nut. Right, so it's coming up that side more easily. Now I can get on this one. Okay, so it's failed there. So it's literally just pushed in there. This one's broken now, but that's fine. It's being replaced anyway. Little tap on the vise, it'll hopefully... There we go. So to get access to the mechanism, there's a pin that comes through the top here with a split pin holding it in place. And then there's this screw on the back here. So you can now see in to the greased mechanism, nicely greased mechanism of the pull. So that little drum there rotates every time you operate the handbrake. And if there's enough to move it on one click, this sprung mechanism here moves up one notch on the pull and adjusts the handbrake. So I'll just pop the pad out now. Right, this part of the pad carrier is actually held onto the mechanism here via the spring that's in the middle there. There we go. And away it comes. So all of this needs to come out, and I've actually got some parts on order to replace it. So I've undone the spring at the bottom here, and then this part just pulls straight out. There we go. Now I can remove
this sprung part here, which is held in that clip. So with all those bits stripped, I'm putting them together in a tub just to keep parts together. So the next job I'm going to tackle is taking apart the hub carrier here. So I need to take the actual hub itself out of the hub carrier with the wheel bearings in the middle there, and I need to take the fulcrum shaft bearings out of the bottom here. So to make a start, we've actually just got a felt seal, a little shim there to help get everything spaced correctly. Okay, one shim, and then we've got the face of the bearing. The felt seal is held in place with what's called a seal retainer, perhaps unsurprisingly. So I need to get, to drift that out, I need to get between the bearing and the seal retainer and start to prise it up. Just there. Okay, so there's the seal retainer. All this is being replaced, of course. And with that, I can just lift out the bearing. Okay, put that to one side. Then inside here, we've got a distance piece, a tube. And then there's the same the other side. So there's some shims in the middle that help centralise all of this within the bottom of the fulcrum shaft pivot. So again, I'm keeping all these parts together so I know which shims went with which spacer tubes and which bearings. So I'm just using these blocks of wood around the hub carrier here to hold it in the press. And at the moment, I'm just using a 30mm socket, so just under size, so I can push the hub out from within the hub carrier. Seems to be drifting out nicely. And there we go. So lifting the hub carrier away. Now, the thing that always struck me with when I pick these up is how light they are. Now, of course, it's an aluminium casting, but it really is extremely light. And I'll be going into more detail in a bit as to why that is and why it's such a successful piece of suspension design. So with that out of the way, then hopefully, got this stuck in there, there we go, lift out the actual hub itself. With the splined hubs out of the hub carriers, I can now get on with the glamorous task of cleaning out the grease and drifting out what remains of the bearings. Also need to pop out the grease point cap as well. So the final tool I'm using on the hub carrier here is the degreaser. After a thorough clean in the degreaser, I've now got one of the hub carriers nice and clean. And it's really amazing to see the amount of contrast, and it's one of the most satisfying aspects of doing this job. So you can actually see some of the original marks in the casting that were made back in 1967. And I can properly inspect the part to see if there's actually any damage that would be of concern. So what I'm looking for is stress cracking and general damage, any signs of corrosion that might cause it to go. So I've seen one around the bleed nipple on other parts before, and around the end here. This all looks okay. So this isn't the finish date for this hub carrier. It's actually going to be vapor blasted next, which will take it onto the next level of finish. I haven't taken out the bearings yet, so you can see the remains of the inner bearings still in there. So the way to start that off is by using a tool like this. This is very handy, so it comes in a set of different diameters. And as long as you've got the one with the right diameter, you can drop that in, like so, and start knocking it through. There we go. So let's pop the bearings out of the bottom, including the seal. So that's a nice tidy job. So now for the seal here and the inner race shell. So what I'll do is I'll pop the oil seal out from the inside with this long screwdriver. The bearing shell itself takes a bit more persuasion. So I find that getting something like this extension bar which has got a rounded face so it won't actually attack or cut into the aluminium casting, and spread the load over a fairly big area on this edge here. And if I go from one side to the other, the bearing shell slowly edges its way out. And I can check now. So I can see a gap growing behind the shell of the bearing here as it edges its way out, and it's protruding slightly more one side than the other. Okay. And then out pings the shell of the outer race of the bearing. On the workbench here, I've got the few remaining parts that I can't do anything more with at the moment. So I've got the handbrake lever mechanism and the differential to take some bits off still. I'll degrease the handbrake mechanism first before taking that apart. With it cleaned up a bit more, I've now taken a photo and I'm going to take it apart. I'm going to be covering the differential in a future episode. So the last bracket I need to get off the rear suspension is actually this one here that mounts the differential that the brake calipers mount to. So as you can see, in the drive shaft here, there's a notch in this plate that allows access to the bolt heads. With this bracket out now, I'll put these bolts back in just to make sure that they don't get confused with anything else. Let's give these brackets a quick clean. I don't really want them going into the sandblaster with muck all over them. I'm now at a pretty good stage of the refurbishment. So I've got all the parts here that I need to put through the sandblaster ready for painting. The hub carriers are ready for vapor blasting now that the bearings are out. And all of these parts are ready for painting once I've done all of the rest of these. Thank you so much for watching. Please join me next time when I continue with the refurbishment and start fitting the new components.